Congressman.
Hello.
Hey, it's good to see you again.
Nice to see you.
Hey, I'm Andy Kroll, the Washington Bureau Chief for Rolling Stone. I just had a great conversation with Congressman Jamie Raskin, who was the lead manager in the second impeachment trial of former President Trump. Raskin and I talked about leading the impeachment case soon after his son Tommy took his own life, why the trial was a victory, and the future of the filibuster. Just off the top here, I just want to say how sorry I am to you and Sarah about Tommy. I can't imagine how
I appreciate that. I very much appreciate your saying it.
On January 5th, obviously, was Tommy's service. The day after that, January 6th, a day that we will never forget, those of us who watched what happened. And then when I heard that you were going to be the lead impeachment manager a couple of weeks later, I have to say my first thought was, Congressman Raskin could have easily said, I need to step away. I need some time off. I need to just grieve for a period. And instead, you took on this role in the impeachment trial. Why did you make that decision?
Well, remember that our daughter, Tabitha, who's our youngest child, was with me on January 6th. Also, our son-in-law, Hank, who's married to our oldest daughter, Hannah, he was with me too. So we were in the middle of our terrible grieving and agony over Tommy when they asked me not to go down to the Capitol on January 6th, that they wanted all of us to be together. And I felt the same way, but I said, why don't they come with me? They can watch the peaceful transfer of power in America. And then we could all go home together. I was one of the Democratic managers opposing these efforts to nullify and reject the votes coming in from Pennsylvania, Arizona, Georgia, some other states. So they decided to come. They did say, well, you know, Trump is getting all of his followers to come. Will it be safe? And I said, of course it'll be safe. It's the Capitol. And little did I know. And that turned into one hell of a bring your daughter to work day. You know, these events were tremendously personal and emotional for everybody on Capitol Hill, whether you were with the democracy and the Capitol police and the Constitution, or you were with the insurrectionists. Everybody was personally engaged and involved in it. And so when the speaker asked me, I suppose it didn't occur to me that there was really a choice. I mean, I talked it over with Sarah and the girls, but I decided that I would do it. And I was very angry about the attack on America, and I remain very angry about it. So there was really nothing else I could do. And I had Tommy with me in my heart and in my chest the entire time.
Do you feel like Tommy would have wanted you to do it as well?
I'm sure he would have. Tommy loved democracy and using government as an instrument of freedom and justice for people, and not as an instrument of tyranny and terror. And he would have wanted me to stand up as we did.
I know you spoke a number of times during the trial about the case for convicting former President Trump and the case for potentially disqualifying him from holding future office. But can you make that case again here?
It's not a difficult case. He was guilty of inciting violent insurrection against the Constitution to nullify and overthrow a presidential election. He essentially tried to use mob violence in order to intimidate Congress and his own vice president in order to prolong his reign in government. He was beaten by Joe Biden by more than 7 million votes. He lost 306 to 232 in the Electoral College, but having exhausted every nonviolent means of trying to stay in power, he decided to turn to a violent insurrection. Nothing like it has ever happened in American history, from George Washington through Barack Obama. I mean, at the end of the trial, the the opposing counsel were saying that we were making up a new cause of action. This is what they called the Raskin doctrine. And I suppose they thought that I would be really embarrassed by that. And I just turned it around and I said, of course it's a new doctrine because this is a new constitutional crime. It had never occurred to any president, starting with Washington, Adams, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, John Quincy Adams, go right down the list all the way through all of the modern presidents that we know, the Bushes and Bill Clinton and Barack Obama. It's absolutely unthinkable that any of them would, as Liz Cheney put it, summon a mob, assemble a mob, incite a mob, light a match, and then direct the fury of this violence against Congress in order to prolong his personal reign. So I don't even think it was a close case. People would say to me, you know, do you think you can get 17 Republican votes to get to 67? And I said, I'm not sure we can get to 67, but I think we can get to 100. I think that we can make a proof that's so overwhelming that they just give up. But I clearly had underestimated the absolute cowardice of these 43 Republican senators and their willingness to behave like members of a religious cult, basically.
I thought there was a point in one of your arguments that you made that I thought really made the case well. I mean, when I was talking with constitutional scholars, legal experts, and so on, the conversation, as it did during the trial, would sometimes go to, is this a crime? Did he criminally incite violence? And I thought you made a point one day where you talked about when the president had a choice between being the commander-in-chief and the inciter-in-chief, when he had the choice to uphold the oath or not, he did not. He sided with the insurrection. And that is a crime against the Constitution?
Absolutely. It's a violation of his oath of office. It's a violation of his constitutional duty under Article 2 to take care that the laws are faithfully executed. And it's an assault on the country. I mean, it's akin to treason, which is one of the enumerated impeachable offenses, treason, bribery, and other high crimes and misdemeanors. So it's absolutely on the same level as treason. I mean, the only thing we were missing, or at least missing the evidence for, was the involvement of a foreign power. So we decided not to go down that road. But it's hard to think of a more impeachable offense than this. He did take on the central role of inciter-in-chief. And the critical evidence for a number of the Republican senators who did vote to convict was that after the violence was unleashed and the president knew about it and people were clamoring for his help and begging him to call off the dogs, he didn't do it. And far from acting as commander-in-chief, who would send in troops and activate the National Guard and do whatever he could to help, he continued to act as the inciter-in-chief. And even after he knew that Vice President Pence was on the run from the mob that Trump had inflamed against him, he continued to tweet against Pence and say that he lacked courage and so on. And this was, you know, back when Trump was making a big show of how his people had to be strong and they were not going to take back the country with weakness. They had to show strength. In the meantime, their great hero refused even to show up to testify for them after betraying the country, the Constitution, and his oath. He even betrayed the mob that he sent to go and attack the Capitol. If he were a real right-wing populist hero like Mussolini, he'd be out there speaking for his people, but he cut them loose too and let his lawyers come up and in a mad effort to try to distance himself from it, denounce them. So he's a traitor and he's a coward. The country's never lived with a figure like him before.
On the first day of the trial, I sat down at my computer and made some notes. I wrote, the senator jurors in this case are both victims and in some cases collaborators. The courthouse was the scene of the crime. Obviously, some of the members of the insurrection got onto the Senate floor on January 6th. The evidence is just out there in the world. In some cases, the insurrectionists live streamed it themselves. And this was a crime that we all watched happen in real time. this was the strangest trial in some ways I can imagine. Well, was it an unwinnable trial?
Everybody who was in the jury, and they were really jurors and judges, but everybody who was on that jury panel was also a witness, certainly to the events, in most cases, a victim of the events, in some cases, collaborators with the president's violent insurrection and his mob. And, you know, there were, of course, judge jurors who were also playing the role of being advisors to the prosecution, I mean, to the defense team. We had no advisors from the Senate, but apparently there were meetings between Senator Cruz and some of the other ones and the defense lawyers who obviously needed the help. Some of that is structural and is built into the Constitution. you know, the GOP senators made much of the fact that Senator Leahy was both a judge and a juror, but of course they were all judges and jurors because the Senate decides matters of law as a judge would do, and also is the adjudicator of facts to determine what actually happened. Here, it shouldn't have been difficult though, because the evidence was so overwhelming and so unrefuted and so irrefutable that any honest juror would have been led to find that the president was guilty of the offense. We couldn't even get the Republicans to commit that it was an impeachable crime to incite a violent insurrection against the Union, much less to agree that this was a high crime and misdemeanor in this case. But Mitch McConnell's press or Mitch McConnell's speech after the trial was deeply revealing, because he essentially embraced the factual case in chief that we had presented. He said we had proven our case, but then went back to hang his hat on that constitutional jurisdictional point that they didn't think that you could conduct a trial in the Senate for someone who was impeached for events committed in office while they were in office, but now was out of office. And that just had no precedent for it. That argument is ridiculous. The very first Senate impeachment was of an official who was a former official. All of the questions that they were relitigating were resolved, adjudicated and resolved by the Senate in the Belknap decision in 1876. In fact, a lot of the things that Mitch McConnell was saying on the floor were taken verbatim from the lawyers for Belknap, who made the argument unsuccessfully that the Senate could not conduct a trial for a former office. But, you know, there was enough propaganda and confusion about that that they could hide behind that constitutional argument. But I could tell that McConnell was profoundly moved by the case that we put forward and was shocked by what the president had done. I mean, lots of people could have been killed that day. The vice president could have been killed. Nancy Pelosi could have been killed. You remember the insurrectionist who said that he wanted to put a friggin' bullet in her brain, or a bullet in her friggin' brain. You know, people could, lots more people could have died. Already the death toll is 7, if you include the officers who committed suicide in the wake of the beatings and pummelings that they received at the hands of Trump's mob. 140 Capitol officers wounded, one lost 3 fingers, one had a heart attack brought on by a taser used by one of the insurrectionists, people with brain damage, people with permanent facial disfigurement and damage. I mean, just the shocking things that took place. And the idea that they would collaborate in sweeping that under the rug, it just adds a profound insult to the injury of those days.
Can you take me a little bit inside the decision over whether to call witnesses or not? There seemed like a brief moment that might happen and then it didn't. What happened there?
The testimony that we wanted to bring in from Congresswoman Jamie Herrera Butler, we brought in. We were able to get a stipulation and we brought it in as uncontradicted sworn testimony. And what she said was that she had heard Kevin McCarthy tell her the story that he had been trying to get in touch with Trump to rescue them. And when he got through to Trump, Trump said, it's not the MAGA people, it's Antifa. And McCarthy contradicted him and said, no, it's not Antifa. We're here with these people. It's your people. And then Trump said, uttered those immortal words, well, that they must just care more about the election than you do, Kevin, or something to the, you know, to that effect. In other words, he knew exactly what they were doing. It was part of his strategy. It was a weapon for leverage in terms of trying to get Pence and the Congress to reject those Electoral College votes. The whole strategy was to deny Biden a majority in the Electoral College and to kick the election into a contingent election in the House where we would vote not one member, one vote, but one state, one vote. And that would have favored Trump's reelection. And if he had gotten that done, even with this totally counterfeit nullification of the electors coming out of these states, he could have quickly proclaimed himself president, perhaps declared martial law to put down the rebellion and the chaos that he had unleashed. And we'd be living in a full-blown banana republic at this point. We came very close to that.
You and other Democratic members of Congress have said that the impeachment trial was necessary on several levels for several important reasons. One of those was accountability matters in a democracy. In a democracy, without accountability for inciting an insurrection is in deep trouble. I want to know, how does the work continue of trying to repair our democracy? Because we just came through an election where the democracy felt like it kind of held on, but maybe by a thread. What needs to happen now in Congress or in the White House to continue that work to really build back up our democracy?
Well, democracy without accountability is no democracy at all. It's the people's government. We the people govern. And if we don't have access to the truth of events, then it's just not a democracy anymore. It's the people like Donald Trump who want to pull the strings and manipulate the levers of power for their own glory and their own self-perpetuation. So we feel like we won the trial. I mean, it was a 57-43 vote. You know, Donald Trump is trying to convince people he was vindicated by it. Far from it. I mean, it's true he beat the constitutional spread, which was 67-33, but that's very different from winning. We won a decisive majority, 57-43. Seven Republicans joined us, Republicans from New England, the Mid-Atlantic, the South, the Midwest, the West, Alaska, and their right-wing cancel culture is scrambling to try to censure all of these people, just like they scrambled to try to depose Liz Cheney as the number three Republican, the head of the House Republican Conference, because she had spoken so forcefully about the guilt of Donald Trump and stated that no president had ever betrayed the presidential oath as badly as Donald Trump. This was the worst betrayal of a presidential oath of office in our history, she said. So they had to go after her, but she survived that. So, you know, Donald Trump destroys everything around him, and he will destroy the Republican Party. They will live to regret that they were not willing to live up to their oaths of office here. So Trump is going to he's going to pay the price with all these criminal prosecutions, the civil lawsuits that are starting to mount, the class action lawsuits, the Ku Klux Klan Act lawsuits. And he is rapidly becoming a political pariah. Nobody outside of the right wing of the Republican Party is going to want to go anywhere near him. So I think that he's made himself part of the past. We have to make sure he remains part of the past and make sure that the future is coming. But meantime, we have to repair all of the damage that he did. He turned us into a failed state. Look at COVID-19. We lead the world in death count. We lead the world in the number of cases. And Biden and Harris have been moving very quickly to respond the way that a mature modern democracy should be responding, with science rather than opposed to science, rather than spreading propaganda about fake miracle cures and lying about the disease. So we've got to get on top of that. We've got to confront the nightmare of climate change and the accelerating natural catastrophes associated with that, which we see piling up all over the place, from loss of hundreds of thousands of acres to wildfire in the West, to flooding all over the country, to drought in parts of the country, to these shocking winter events in Texas and in other states that are taking place right now. So we've got to confront all of those problems at the same time that we defend democratic institutions. And that means we've got to educate the public about the Constitution, about the Bill of Rights. You know, we've got these alternative media systems that are just leading the country down a road to ruin in terms of polarization and division. I watched Fox News one of the nights of the trial when I got home. It was around 9 or 10 o'clock. And they didn't even mention the trial, much less show any of our footage of the events. It was all about their completely fraudulent claim that Officer Sicknick had not actually been killed in the violence by the mob. And they were, you know, it reminded me of their birth certificate thing with Barack Obama that Donald Trump got started with. They were looking for Officer Sicknick's death certificate. So, I mean, that's the kind of totalitarian style propaganda that has been destroying American civic culture. And we need to rebuild the idea of facts and truth being the foundation for common discussion and understanding. People can disagree about different values and different agendas, but when you have people just lying about what's going on, it's very tough to engage in democratic discussion.
I feel like one of the big questions that's going to come to a boiling point really in the next few weeks or few months, and this is in the Senate, not in the House, but as a constitutional expert, I wanted to ask you about it, is what to do about the filibuster. I mean, the filibuster is this antiquated, some say anti-democratic tool that can be used to block progress. You know, we can get COVID relief through, but HR1, for instance, voting reforms, money in politics reforms are stuck because of the filibuster. Do you think the filibuster needs to go?
Well, the filibuster is not in the Constitution. In fact, arguably, it runs counter to the values and the principles of the Constitution, which are of a majoritarian nature, not a super majoritarian nature. And we know that historically, the filibuster was a weapon of the segregation of senators to stop civil rights progress in the country. The Republican Party is a small minority party, and it's getting smaller all the time, and it's going to just be the Trump party. But they don't mind that so much if they can manipulate the levers of power in such a way as to prevent progress in the country. That's the role of the filibuster. That's the role the Electoral College, with all of its booby traps, has been playing for them. And that's the role of gerrymandering. So the filibuster is a legislative instrument which allows a small minority of the country to essentially tyrannize the majority. So I hope that the Senate will deal with it. I can't say I've studied it closely. I haven't written articles about it or anything, but I'm definitely cheering for the side of reform.
And I just want to go back to the impeachment trial.
Yes.
Was it worth it? Was it worth presenting that case? Do you feel like it made a difference, that it mattered, even if there wasn't a conviction?
Well, I mean, more important even than the decisive 57-43 victory we had in the Senate was the fact that Donald Trump was convicted forevermore after in the court of public opinion and in the court of history. And, you know, the guy who likes to slap his name on everything, including things he has nothing to do with, tried to keep his name away from this after the nightmare unfolded. But this will be the one event that he is best known for throughout history. And he will be known as a liar, a traitor, and a coward for what he did to America. And the trial will be viewed as the moment when patriotic America stood up against this right-wing authoritarianism that's been running over our institutions.